Got an interesting one today. These are the BMR1 Nearfield Monitors from Drop. I immediately fell in love with the look of these. This industrial design, you can mount these vertical or horizontal. They've got a bunch of different add-on magnetic grills that you can color match to your setup. They operate wired or in Bluetooth. And in their base form, these won't kill your wallet. These start at only $129, but we will talk about how that price can change as we move through the video. I've also seen plenty of recurring criticisms of these in the user reviews over on Drop, so we will touch on all that stuff today as we go. The BMR in the name is for balanced mode radiators, so they're not using the traditional cone-shaped diaphragms that we see in most loudspeaker designs. They make a lot of claims about this driver design, and there's a lot of technical info there that I will link down in the description if you do want to know more, but the big stuff you need to know, they offer wide dispersion, so you don't need the speakers pointed directly at you, and they claim this does a better job of filling the room with sound or handling multiple listeners. I find this to be true. They have increased dimensionality and sound staging that helps to create a wider, more immersive sound because they don't need a crossover. That's a component that directs certain frequencies to the tweeter and to the woofer because these are single driver. I found this to be true as well. And because the driver design is a flat disc, you can have a much smaller speaker enclosure. These measure 11.5 inches tall, but just a little over 2.5 inches wide and just about 1.5 inches deep. So that's how we wind up with a really small footprint on the desk and the very solid option to be able to mount these vertically or horizontally depending on your desk layout or your aesthetic preference. Inside the box, it's pretty sparse. You get two speakers, two stands, hardware to attach them yourself, a power cable, a 3.5 millimeter cable, and a proprietary cable for linking the two speakers together. I was surprised that the only documentation included in the box at all is this little sticker on the power brick. The stands aren't anything impressive. It's important to point out that these are designed to have a little bit of play in the tilt of the speaker in case your desk isn't perfectly level. If you don't understand the intention of the design, your first instinct would be to really crank down on these until there's no play at all, but they're not designed like that, and I worry that you would crack these plastic stands if you cranked on those too hard. All your controls are on the right side, mostly behind the speaker. We've got a 3.5 millimeter input, a proprietary port to bridge both speakers, and a headphone out. Now the headphone out here is not gonna drive headphones that would normally require an amp. So in Drop terms, you'll be good with like an HD58X or a 17.7X Go, not with like a 6XX or a DT1990. We also have a 3.5 millimeter aux out and a 2.0 to 2.1 switch, which we'll talk about in a second. I'm a big fan of being able to customize my desk space, so these add-on magnetic grills here are a great add for me. They come in a bunch of different colors, but the speakers themselves don't include any grills. Almost all of these are a $25 add-on. I'm okay with that because it keeps the base price down, and if you're gonna buy a colored grill, chances are you're just gonna take off the ones that came on the speakers, put them in a box on a shelf anyway. I would like these better at around $20, but it just is what it is. They feel good, they're easy to take on and off, and if you can nail down a solid color coordination between your keycaps and your desk mat, it's a W. Around the front of the right speaker, you've got an LED lit button that functions as a mode select. This is how you get the headphone mode and Bluetooth. Pairing these is really intuitive. I didn't need to look for any instructions, but there is a quick start guide on Drop's website if you need it. That brings us to our first bit of criticism here. There is no power off mode or switch. If you want to power these down, you have to completely unplug the unit. Drop says the power draw isn't significant when these are just idling, but it still feels weird to me to not have an off switch. You'll also get a really loud, nasty pop anytime you plug or unplug the cable from your source, so I would plug that first and then plug in the cable. I've seen people say the LED on the front is way too bright. I think that's very subjective. Having owned things where the LED is way too bright, this one on my copy doesn't bother me at all. But the one exclusion that really does bother me, there's no physical volume adjustment on these, and that's a big miss for me. If I'm using something as a Bluetooth device and I need to turn it down in a hurry, my instinct is to run to the thing that's making the noise, not necessarily the source, like my phone. If you're on the PC side, this is fine. If your keyboard or some other device on your desk controls system volume, but the last thing I want to do is tab out of my game to make a volume adjustment. Even when I'm playing single player stuff, I have a tendency to ride the physical volume control of my speakers as scenes get louder or quieter. And the physical multimedia controls that you get on some keyboards don't always behave the same way in game as they do when you're on the desktop. One way around this is if you're running a desktop headphone DAC amp that has outputs controlled by the volume knob. But I only recommend this to people that really know their gear because it's really easy to overload a powered speaker by sending additional power to it. And with some hardware like the iFi Zendak V2, which I still highly recommend, you completely forfeit any control over the Windows digital system volume just by using it. So this is still very much a workaround, not an ideal solution. This is another helpful little piece that I use with desktop monitors that only have volume control on the rear of the speaker cabinet. It's called a vol box, and it just sits in your input chain. It is a bit pricey for what it is at like 18 bucks, but it's a lifesaver in certain audio setups. It's also great if you need to add some cable length between your source and your speakers. Speaking of, the 3.5 millimeter aux cable that they include to hook up to your source is only 3.25 5 feet long. If you're using a standing desk, you're gonna need to spring for another cable. As for the cable that links the two speakers, it is proprietary. Now, nobody likes proprietary cables, but all my 2.0 or 2.1 systems use them. It being proprietary wouldn't have been an issue at all if they had just made it a bit longer. As it is, it's just a hair over 4 feet, and you can't go get a longer cable to replace it because one doesn't exist. If you've got a side-by-side dual monitor setup, it's not gonna work. You're pretty much limited to a single monitor. I'd say 32 inches is the absolute max. Ultra wides are probably out. You will still have some restrictions on how wide you can get, and you'll have some issues too if you're the type of person that puts a premium on cable management. Drop has already announced plans for a longer version of this cable. They're in the process of sourcing this now. I really hope we see a situation where they take care of the people that were early adopters that were affected by this. Talking sound quality, my impression of these varies a lot by genre. They're gonna do way better with tracks that require a little bit of bass warmth, not a lot of deep bass to sell the experience. Some things hold true regardless. They are very detailed. They can be pretty unforgiving to a rough mix. There's solid separation and detail in the mids and highs. All the vocalists, male and female, sound true and accurate. I don't think it's fair to say there's no bass. You do get some warmth and a decent fill from the low mids, and they just start to rub the top of that bass frequency range right at like that 60 to 70 hertz mark. You're not gonna get any bass punch or slam. You're not gonna get those low, round, tonal notes. There's no sub bass here at all, but I wouldn't expect any of that out of a desktop micro monitor system like this. In the mids and highs, I never really hear them struggle, even at high volumes. It's only when they're trying to get low that I pick up on some distortion. I like these better in their vertical orientation because you do get a pretty convincing, like, tall wall of sound effect going on. When they're horizontal, it sounds wider instead of taller for obvious reasons. And they do have solid off-axis performance, but the best experience is still having them pointed at you sitting in the sound field. On the gaming side, that three-dimensional sound quality, that big sound stage, it's cool for single-player gaming. It's not enough of an effect that it's going to be a better option than headphones or IEMs for a competitive FPS setting. Musically, it's going to be easier for me to paint a better picture for you if we just compare them to some similar stuff. This is a portable Bluetooth speaker from LG. It's a PL5. I got it free with my TV a couple years ago. This originally retailed for $129.99 as well. The BMR1s sound considerably better than this in every metric. The speakers I usually keep on my gaming desk are the Arena 7 gaming monitors from SteelSeries. This is a 2.1 system with a 6-inch powered sub. These retail for $299. Being honest, I barely use these. I keep them around mainly for how they look on camera when I'm shooting the gaming desk because of the lighting. Cutting off the powered sub for a more apples to apples comparison, again, I would give it to the BMR1. It's got a much richer sound than these satellites alone. There is an Arena 3 at $129 that's only a 2.0 system. The speakers have a different single 4-inch driver design that are full range. That's probably the more accurate comparison, but I don't have them on hand. Lastly, I have these IK Multimedia iLoud Micros. This is a 2.0 system used mainly for studio reference monitoring. These retail for $349. These have a stupid amount of bass for a product this size. They've also got some really cool adjustments on here too. Like, you've got hardware switching for DSP and for room placement compensation. Any setting where I can't really use a sub because it's gonna disturb the neighbors, these are my go-to. I've had these for years now. Not surprising is that these overtake the BMR1s in the low end. They've got a much richer, fuller sound overall. But very surprising is that the BMR1s really give these a strong run for their money in the highs and high mids. On some tracks, I actually prefer the BMR1s. They have a noticeable difference in how big the sound feels in the room. Like on EDM tracks that have big swells or buildups, you almost feel those moments kind of wrap around you. The detail and resolution between the two is, again, surprisingly spot on given the big price difference. So sound-wise, the BMR1 is lacking in bass. And that really shouldn't come as a shock to anyone given the size and the single 2-inch full-range drivers here. But we have options. You can easily add almost any powered sub to this setup because we have that aux out in the back, and we've got that switch that goes from 2.0 to 2.1 so that we can roll off some of those lower frequencies that it struggles with directly to the sub. The one I'm using for testing is a Canto Sub 8. It's a powered 125 watt RMS 8-inch sub. You can find these for right around $200. You're on your own for a cable here as well. I'm using a simple 1/8-inch to dual RCA here. To keep that obvious train rolling today, adding a powered sub that costs more than the speaker system itself results in a pretty killer audio experience. You get that room-filling sound out of the BMR1, and with the sub handling the low end, a setup like this can easily provide enough sound to fill a room anywhere from 800 to maybe 1200 square feet. My main room here is about 900 square feet, and there's more than enough sound and bass here to warrant a complaint from the neighbors. I have to restrict this sub to about 25-35% volume. These are sitting on my gaming desk in the back corner of the room, pointed at the opposite wall, and these sound good no matter where you are in the room. A setup like this would be perfect for an apartment. There are some cheaper 8-inch power powered subs out there, like from Dayton Audio. They'll get you for right around $135. That would bring the total cost of this system to under $300 with the grill kit, and that's gonna be a really solid experience. So I've seen a lot of conversation about how warm these speakers get. Honestly, I feel like it's overblown. First of all, if you're running Bluetooth, these never even get over what I would consider slightly warm. If you're running wired, yeah, it does get warmer. There's a Class D amplifier in here in a very small enclosure, but I've seen comments where people say they can't even touch their speakers. I don't get that on my copy. I can drive these hard for a couple hours, and the only place that really gets very warm or borderline hot is the lower panel of the enclosure on the right side only. You actually have to reach up under there to even make contact. It could be that I'm just used to using a headphone amp on my desk. Those can commonly run warm or hot to some people, but I don't see anything here that's cause for concern or that I think would shorten the lifespan of the speaker. It's tough to figure out where to place these value-wise because there are just a ton of options in a 2.0 or 2.1 desktop speaker system between $100 and $300. In a personal use case, a 2.0 system, one that doesn't have a sub, isn't gonna do a lot for me. I'm not gonna use it to watch movies because there's not enough bass there to really get me immersed in the experience, and that mainly holds true for most single player games as well. I'm definitely not using a desktop speaker system for competitive gaming. That's a job for headphones or IEMs. I would mainly use something like this for productivity or casual music listening, background stuff, or social situations where you have people over. These are a decent experience on their own, especially for the price point, but that sub adds so much that I could see myself using them for almost everything at the desktop and probably using them as like my main Bluetooth streamer system in an apartment, dorm room, any small room setting. The cable situation definitely needs to be addressed, and the lack of physical volume control is a big miss. There's a reason why nearly every desktop multimedia speaker solution on the market has either a physical volume control or remote. I really like the design aesthetic. I love the customization of the grill color and the flat mounting options, and I really do enjoy the sound for the price point. They have a lot of volume, a lot of clarity, and they really do present a surprisingly big sound field out of a very small footprint. If these happen to fit with your desk goals in their current form, great. Otherwise, what I see is a system and a speaker tech that shows a lot of promise, but needs some definite refinement on the user experience side. Everything we talked about today is linked down in the description. If you got some value out of today's video, please drop a like or consider subscribing if you're not already. If you want to get specific gear recommendations or just chat with some people who are really knowledgeable and into the kind of thing that you're into, check out our private Discord, which you can do right here. That's it for today. I will catch you all in the next one. Stay up.